Store for them is a snatch speed ladder, 5 barbell starting at 190, moving up 10 pounds to 200, and then going up by 5 at 205, 210, and 215.
So proudly we at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous
The following is a presentation of CrossFit HQ.
Welcome back to the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games as we move from the soccer stadium to the tennis stadium for Friday Night Lights. I'm Chase Ingham. Alongside with me is Bill Grundler and Mike Arsenault as we get set to tackle event number 4, Sprint Snatch Ladder. And after 3 events, your standings, Jonikoski holding a slight edge on Matthew Fraser, with Bjorgen Carl Gudmundsson rounding out your third place position. But Bill, 5 out of the top 5, 3 in that European regional,
which is going to be amazing. But this event, that speed snatch ladder, 5 bars, 190 pounds, 200, 205, 210, 215. Squat snatch, not just a power snatch, but a squat snatch. So it's going to be a race to the finish. Jonikoski is going to be in jeopardy because he's sizing up with Matt Fraser, who's going to be really good.
Your lane assignments for quarterfinal heat number 1. And Bill, when I look at the snatch 1 rep maxes for these athletes, it looks more like a clean speed ladder with 4 guys over 300 pound snatches.
So out of the gate, we're going to be looking at the massiveness of Roy Gamboa. I mean, he comes in with a 310-pound one-rep max snatch, which is just unbelievable. But not only that, he was able to hit in the regionals. He hit 270 pounds. I'm fine as we see it. No, I'm good. Just as you go, as you melt from one to the other, I'll just pick it. I'll just go.
As you melt from one to the other.
Just melt. Melt in. Melt on.
Yes? You want me to do it? You sure? Okay.
Cool.
Song.
Every time I hear it, I think of Emily Bridgers.
It makes me freak out that I can hear you.
Don't freak out.
What? Not that. Like, usually I only hear you for live.
I know. But now every time I hear the song, I think of my daughter doing it because she's like, "Whip, can watch me, baby." Okay. Stand by. It's Williams and...
It's Robin Williams. It's going to be real weird.
Oh, Conway. Adrian Conway.
You got to wind up like a pitcher.
Watch me. Ooh. Ooh.
That beard, that hair, it's fantastic.
Yeah. Yes,
it'd be so hot.
Man, yeah, it was really warm down there.
Imagine the year where they mad at that whole thing with in black mats. That first year,
dude,
it's terrible.
They were walking around the warm up area with one of the heat guns to see how hot it was back there because the mats were doing this.
Mm.
I can only imagine. At the warm area where we were.
Oh,
yeah.
How many do they take? 20?
Yeah. 20 to the semis. 40-25?
40-20.
40-25? 5. Yeah.
8 heats, 4 heats.
Good afternoon and welcome back to continuing coverage of the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games as we take our individual men from the soccer stadium to the Friday night lights at the tennis stadium. I'm Chase Singham and alongside with me is Bill Grundler and Mike Arsenault as we get set to tackle the Snatch Speed Ladder for event number 4. And after 3 events, this leaderboard is changing yet again and getting a little tighter at the top. Jonikoski leads Matt Fraser by just 4 points. But we have 3 European men in the top 5, something we haven't seen since the CrossFit Games began back in 2007. And this event, Bill, Snatch Speed Ladder, this was announced, and we couldn't be more excited that it's back.
We saw something like this with the clean and jerk, with the clean speed ladder last year, and now we're going to get all the excitement back again. 5 bars, 190 pounds, 200, 205, 210, 215, and this is going to be exciting with these guys. We have some big dogs that are going to throw around some big weights really fast.
The big dogs we have in this heat specifically, Bill, there are 3 guys that boast a 300-pound snatch or more. Had I been looking at this without any reference, I would have thought this was a clean speed ladder.
Very powerful, guys. And right out of the gate, Roy Gamboa, so strong. He shows that he has a 310-pound one-rep max snatch. He put up 270 pounds. Nick, 305 is a one-rep max and put up 290 in the regionals. So this is going to be exciting to see these two big guys go head-to-head.
Chad Melton,
rookie
with a 300-pound snatch, making his debut at the CrossFit Games. Heat 1 of 8 in the qualifying round. 5 men racing across the tennis stadium as Nick Urenkar is off to a savage pace. One of the strongest snatches we saw at the regional level from the central region. As these 5 men are racing to try to get one of those precious 20 qualifying spots going into the semifinal rounds. It'll be Nick Urenkar, Chad Melton. And Nick Urenkar, Chad Melton. It'll look like Chad Melton will just out-touch Nick Urenkar. Unofficial time of 30 seconds. Nick Urenkar, 0.6 seconds behind him. Gamboa rounding out top 3. As Kevin Simons having a little bit of trouble with this. And we got to understand, as these guys just finished Murph maybe 90 minutes ago, Bill, and I don't know if you know, is that finishing Murph usually takes me a 90-day recovery.
It's just so impressive that these guys can move that fast. But what was great about Chad Melton, he managed the bounce of the bar. So not only is he strong enough to get that bar up and over his head, but he put the bar down, no bobble at all, going from one bar to the next bar. And that's where he was able to make that distance up over Nick Urenkar. Look how powerful. Boom, up and over. Easy step and just a real quick run to the finish. Just edged out Nick Urenkar, who was moving the bar just as easily, just as well.
Chad Melton, rookie CrossFit Games athlete coming out of California, will take heat number 1. Unofficial time 30.2. Nick Urenkar 30.8 just behind him. And Roy Gamboa getting third place with 32.7. As we reshuffle, we have 7 more heats remaining in this quarterfinal. We have 40 male athletes coming in. 20 will be moving on based off their fastest top 20 times. Heat 2. Your lineup, Neil Maddox. Someone to keep your eye on, won the speed clean ladder last year. The guy definitely has a lot of strength. Right now he's sitting down there in about 34th or 35th place. Not somewhere where he wants to be. He's had a rough few events leading in, but keep your eye on this man, Lucas Parker.
And Lucas Parker, the thing with him is he's just so powerful. He's known for his Olympic lifting. But here's the issue with Lucas. He normally has such a long setup into each one of his lifts. So can he do a speed snatch ladder like this? I just don't know. Whereas Neil Maddox is so powerful, and he knows the tempo of this particular race. He's going to be fast and furious.
Heat two underway. Speed snatch ladder starting at 190 pounds, moving to 200 pounds. Neil Maddox, top part of your screen. No shirt, blue shorts, making very quick work. You can't play to the speed of your heat, and Neil Maddox is just tearing through these snatch ladders. Neil Maddox drops at 210. That could be costly. There is no time for this. Neil Maddox on the right. Lucas Parker on the left. Lucas Parker. One more to go and a sprint across. It'll be Lucas Parker and Aaron Hanna. So Lucas Parker.
Wow, that took me by surprise. I was not expecting that.
Aaron Hanna. So Aaron Hanna, 30.65. And look at that time for Neil Maddox at the top part of your screen. 32.3 is Julian Alperaz, another Games rookie coming out of the California Regional.
And something we need to look at with this particular event, they're moving forward, so that's going to really change the positioning and how they're pulling off the ground. So if they get a little unbalanced, like that's what happened with Neil Maddox, just was moving too far forward a little bit, could not get that arm locked out in that good position. Because this weight is not heavy for him. You see him come up to the bar, he was just ripping the bars off the ground, but just that little bobble out of position, and the weight comes down.
It's a lot different than doing that speed clean ladder as a last year. Just the way you catch this bar in that position overhead is you can't just rip it and throw it up over your head. There has to be that technical aspect involved. And just edging out Lucas Parker, Aaron Hanna will take heat number two. Aaron Hanna, CrossFit Games rookie, been knocking on the door for a couple years. He gets his shot today. Aaron Hanna, 30.69, and Lucas Parker, 30.97. Aaron Hanna, good enough for second overall, but it is Chad Melton who holds at 30.2. Heat number three. Your lineup, Stephen Fawcett, Elijah Muhammad, Joe Scally, John Parra, and Nathan Bramlett. 10 down, 30 athletes to go. A familiar name you should see on there, especially from the YouTube videos. I'll say two guys that pioneered the 400-pound overhead squat, starting with John Parra.
John Parra, look at the size of this guy. He's like a modern-day superhero, you know? I mean, he's super strong. He's got a great, he boasts a 280-pound snatch. Did 262 in the regionals, but Easy Muhammad, this guy is known for having lifting heavy weights every day. Did 275 pounds in the regionals. I expect to see him go ballistic in this heat.
Elijah Muhammad famously having that touch and go 300 pound snatch.
No big deal.
Well, he'll get his chance today. Heat number three is off. Speed snatch ladder starting at 190, moving to 200. After 200, they'll jump by 5 pounds to 205. Elijah Muhammad on the right side of your screen in the orange shorts, gray tank top, making very quick work, but he has to understand he can't go too fast. But Elijah Muhammad getting chased down by John Parra. Elijah Muhammad has one bar left, and he's at the 22-second mark. The best time we've seen is 32 and no more, 26. 26 seconds for Elijah Muhammad, and John Parra will squeeze in for a second place finish at 30.5. Good enough for first and second. Nathan Bramlett will cross the finish line just under the 40-second mark as Joe Scally working on the 210 bar. Him and Stephen Fawcett still left on the competition floor as we have 10 seconds before that 1 minute time cap.
See, a lot of these guys are getting hung up, but they aren't putting their head through, letting that torso come forward a little bit, and they're just losing position, not getting that bar up over the heels so that they can get a nice stand.
Elijah Muhammad sets the new time to beat by 6 seconds, 26.26 seconds.
Knew he was going to be fast.
Feels
knew
right.
Knew he was going to be fast. I mean, look at this speed. So comfortable. Not only can he move a lot of weight, but his positioning is great. His head goes through, that bar is right over his heels every single time, and it never really bobbled. He didn't have any bobbles at all moving forward as he's throwing that weight around.
Elijah Muhammad had a tough first three events with the long swim, sandbag, and Murph. But he has been licking his chops for the snatch speed ladder at 26.26, a new time to beat set by Elijah Muhammad. We are slowly working our way through these quarterfinal heats. Three heats down, five more heats to go. as we trade one great lifting athlete for another. Spencer Hendel in lane number one. Definitely an athlete we need to keep our eye on.
With Spencer, we've seen him. It's great to see him back in the games finally. But Scott Panther, we've been watching him. We've watched, you know, with Rich Froning out of the way. We were looking to see some big things. He needs to do well in this particular event. He's had a rough three events so far. We know Scott's extremely strong. His one-rep max is 275 pounds, and he threw that up in the regional event. So we're going to see something big from him. Spencer Hendel, he's known for his snatch, just like Easy Muhammad is. It's great to see him back in the games here, and I expect to see this big kid throw some weight around.
All athletes set and ready to go. Heat number four, speed snatch ladder.
Stand by.
Heat four is off. All athletes trying to chase the time just set by Elijah Muhammad, 26.2 seconds. Out of the gates real fast. Panchik, Alex Vigneault are in the lead. All athletes are basically tied, but Alex Vigneault is pulling ahead. He's on the left side of your screen. Watch for Spencer Hendel on the far right. Three athletes getting to the bar at the same time. Scott Panchik on the left. Alex Vigneault just to his right. But it could be Alex Vigneault. Alex Vigneault out touches Scott Panchik by 0.3 seconds, 29.30. And Hendel sneaks in between the two. Spencer Hendel, 29.54. Panchik, 29.66.
Great race for Vigneault right there. What was impressive was he was being pushed by Panchik and by Hendel, but he was able to keep his composure, didn't get out of position. I mean, look at the bounce. This is the other aspect you have to think about, is getting over the bar. Vigneault was great. So smooth. Looked both sides to see what he needs to do. Real, real smart athletic movement there. And there's that foot placement.
And we have four heats down. 20 men have gone, 20 more remaining. Only 20 will be moving on. And someone who needs to be looking at the scoreboard is one of the favorites coming in, is Neil Maddox. But Alex Vigneault, 29.3, will take first in heat number four, followed by Spencer Hendel and Scott Panchik. All athletes under that 30-second mark. That time of 26.26 will stand for Elijah Muhammad. Heat number five getting set to make their way out onto the tennis stadium floor. Travis Williams in lane one, Rob Forte, Adrian Conway. Austin Maliolo is back in action with Chad Cole rounding out your five athletes for heat number five. And the race is getting tighter to see who those qualifying spots are going to be.
Someone I'm real interested to see how they do in this particular heat is going to be Adrian Conway. But there's Austin Maliolo. What I love about Austin being out there is he's one of the old school guys. You know, he's been around for a long time, was in the games a bunch of years, wasn't in the games for a bunch of years, and he's back. And man, he was impressive at Murph. And I really want to see what this long arm guy can do in this particular event. Travis Williams has a 280-pound one-rep max snatch, threw up 260-pound in the regionals. So again, hopefully he got to see some of those heats ahead of him to find out just what he needs to do. This kid's a fighter, and he's a rookie, but I think he's going to put some weight up and move fast. He loves this kind of stuff.
Travis Williams had a great performance in the South region during that speed clean ladder after the muscle-ups, as heat five is set and ready to go. 190 pounds is the first bar as athletes make very quick work of that, but a little stumble for Austin Maliolo on the left side of your screen. Chad Cole on the far right. First athlete to the second bar, Travis Williams in the upper left. Travis Williams, no shirt, moving ahead, picking up where he left off at the South Regional. Travis Williams at the 22-second mark will make it to the last bar. He is the first athlete matched by Chad Cole. Chad Cole will drop, and Travis Williams will finish first in heat number five. Chad Cole is done. Chad Cole, known more for his gymnastics skills, as your third place finisher will be Rob Forte at 37.67.
And Austin battling with the snatch. This was not this particular event, but this movement is what kept him out of the games in 2014. He had that hang snatch that you had to do. This is what he didn't do very well at, and that's why he didn't make it last year.
Posse Maliola gets time capped, and Travis Williams will be your heat winner, 30-48.
Travis Williams, we knew he was going to move fast, but what was most impressive is he was actually bringing the bar down so it wouldn't bounce. Watch how he puts the bar down. Less bounce, very fast over the bar. I think that's going to do really well, especially when they get into that next round.
Five heats down as Travis Williams caps off this heat with a heat win. 30-48 is the time. And overall, this is one of the slowest heats we've had. Travis Williams having the only time at that 30-second mark. Some of your best times are right around 26 230. As we have three more heats remaining, only 15 athletes left to go before we find out who our 20 athletes will be moving on into the semifinal round. As we get deeper in these heats, the names get bigger and bigger. Dan Bailey and Ben Smith with Graham Holmberg, Con Porter and Tyson Takasaki. We got some fast, strong athletes.
Dan Bailey, he's a fan favorite. We love to see him out here. He's always doing really well. He had an amazing regional this year coming out of the California region. Very powerful athlete, very strong on the snap. So I think this is going to be a good workout for him. And he loves when things are fast. Ben Smith, this guy lifts weights, and he's always done that for a really long time. He knows, again, the speed of this because he's done these speed ladders before, and he's so great at the snatch. So I expect to see a big event from Ben also.
Ben Smith currently sitting in that 13th place position, working to get himself back in the top 10.
Stand by.
Heat six is off, and Graham Holmberg first to the bar. 190 pounds over his head. A little bit of a stumble for Rob Forte. Tyson Takasaki in the center lane in the blue and gray shirt. Orange shorts. Tyson Takasaki, an early leader, but trying to keep pace with him. Ben Smith just up to the top of the screen. But watch out for Takasaki. 300-pound listed snatch with Ben Smith first to the last bar, and he will get across. Unofficial time, right around 28 seconds, 29:10. And Takasaki will finish second. And one name we haven't said who's having a lot of trouble, right side of your screen, Dan Bailey.
Now, this is the thing that Dan usually has. Dan is such a great athlete, but once something doesn't start to go right, he seemed to kind of have a mental struggle with it. He wants to do so well that, you know, that one rep failure played into it last 2 years ago at the regionals. Same thing. Got hung up on that. He needs to keep it calm, stay relaxed, be the smooth criminal that he normally is, and just get through the workout. He'll be fine.
Dan Bailey struggling in this heat. Just to show you, there's no room for error with an event so quick.
So again, it's just, you know, trying to get through the events, trying to get through each of those bars, and if it doesn't work, you know you're behind, and you don't have the ability to have a failure like that. Not in this fast of a race. But Ben Smith looked smooth. He was behind a little bit the first couple bars, but brought the bar down. And I think the heavier the weight gets, the better he's going to be.
Ben Smith, your heat number six winner, unofficial time of 29.1 seconds. Second place, Tyson Takasaki. Con Porter wrapping out your top three of heat number six. Two heats left to go in this quarterfinals. It's getting tight at the top. It's Ben Garrard in lane one, Jacob Hettner, Noah Olson, Alex Anderson, and Cole Sager make their way onto the tennis court.
Alex Anderson, a very strong athlete. He has a 3-hole 5, one rep max snatch. However, in the snatch event at the regionals this year, he was only able to put up 256. So under pressure, it might throw him off. We have to see what it's going to do for him. Ben Garrard, 300-pound snatch as well. Shorter athlete, so his range of motion is going to be quick. I think in a speed ladder like this, it's going to work well for him.
And if we remember how the ladder went at the regional level, Ben Garrard probably had the most popular performance of the muscle-ups in clean ladder.
jumping himself from 10th to 5th.
Heat number 7 in. Getting set. Ben Garrard on the right side of your screen. Noah Olsen, center lane. Noah Olsen currently sitting in 6th place overall. Cole Sager on the left side of your screen in the blue shirt, white shorts. Ben Garrard, Cole Sager, Noah Olsen all to the bar, but Cole Sager has a slight edge in the back side of your screen. Watch for Cole Sager on the far right. Noah Olsen in the center. Ben Garrard on the far left. Noah Olsen will miss in the race between Garrard and Sager. And sneaking in the top three, Alex Anderson. And Noah Olsen continues to shoot himself in the foot.
He's having a tough time. He's having a tough time. This is the opposite of what we saw last year at the game, when he just always seemed to end up on top, kind of like a cat always landing on his feet, not quite landing on his feet right now. Not doing bad, just not what he wants.
Quick out of the gates. It was Noah Olsen on the far left side as Cole Sager. Noah Olsen looking to take it, but it was that last bar that gave him some fits.
Cole Sager looks so powerful, and what I liked is he was able to take, I don't want to say enough time to stop, but just was very aware of his body the whole time.
Ben Garrard just trying to edge out Cole Sager. 31-01, 31-08. That is the closest finish we've seen. Thank goodness for that chip timer, as we have just one heat left to go. And those will be your top five men after three events. And Bill, like we said earlier, three of the top five coming out of the Meridian Regional. These guys have stepped up their game this year.
This is definitely a melting pot heat right here. I mean, look at that, all those different flags up there. I think that's, one, I think that's really, really impressive to see that. But two, look at who we have in there. This is going to be kind of a dangerous event for one of these particular athletes. Jankowski has had a tremendous first day and a half of his CrossFit Games, but of all the athletes, he has the lowest listed one rep max, so this is going to be very tough for him. I mean, you want to say damage control, but I don't know. I mean, there's going to be a lot of damage, I believe, in this one.
Jankowski holds a 4-point edge over this man, Matt Fraser, who came in second after Murr, so he's not just a barbell freak. I mean, but he is a barbell freak,
and this event is going to be insane. But yeah, he's got a motor now too. Deadly, deadly combination.
Top five men getting set. This is the last and final heat of the quarterfinals. And the top 20 men will move their way into the semifinals. Heat 8 is off and underway. Matt Fraser in the yellow shirt and orange shorts in the center part of the lanes. Just above him in the white, Jankowski, your current overall leader, by just 4 points over Matt Fraser. Fraser first to the bar. Look for Chad McKay, big man from Australia, working his way through the barbells. They're at 210 pounds. Matt Fraser is done. He'll be the first one to the last bar. 215 pounds up and over his head. And Matt Fraser, that is good enough. Chad McKay will finish in second, just to his right. Goodmanson, Holberg trying to finish. And Bill, like you said, Jankowski, not his event coming in. It is somewhat of a damage control.
Well,
that was pretty impressive.
That was pretty awesome right there. So he may have missed the bar, but he threw a little ninja trick in. That's okay. If you're going to go out with some style. So again, he's approaching his one rep max. On top of just have done Murr. He knew this was going to be a bad one for him. But Matt Fraser, the speed and control of this guy when it comes to a barbell movement is just so impressive. Jankowski we knew this was going to be rough for him. I didn't expect it to be this rough, but that's pretty cool. That was pretty cool. But Matt Fraser, this is all his heat. So smooth. Look at the speed at which he's able to get down underneath that bar. Again, I think the heavier the weight gets, the better he's going to be for against the other athletes. And also being a little bit shorter, snaps his movement.
Matt Fraser, good enough for first place in this heat. That should be good enough for him to move on to the semifinals. We have 8 heats done, 40 athletes have gone through the speed clean or speed snatch ladder, and 20 will be moving on to the semifinals.
From long and grueling to fast and heavy. Hello, everybody, and welcome inside the tennis stadium, the StubHub Center in Carson, California. I'm Sean Woodland alongside Bill Grundler. Nikki Brazier will be joining us momentarily. We had the long event Murph. Now it's time to go heavy and go fast.
And I love these events. We saw so much fanfare last year with the cleans. This year we're going with the snatch speed ladder. This time, second round. 220 pounds, 230, 235, 240, and 245 pounds as fast as you can squat, snatch them up.
40 men started climbing on the ladder, 20 remain. The 20 fastest times from the quarterfinal heats. Plenty of fans in the stands here at the tennis stadium, the StubHub Center, a warm, sunny day in Southern California as these fans have gathered here to watch the fittest men and women on earth attack the most grueling test of fitness, the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games. Lane assignments for the first of four semifinal heats. The top five times will move on to the winner-take-all final. Neil Maddox in lane two had a stumble in the quarterfinals, but still managed to make it through.
And that's just a testament to how fast he was moving. If he wants to get further through here, he's going to have to be much sharper and much more controlled as he goes in. You cannot afford to make a mistake. Now, granted, the weights are getting heavier, so it's going to be approaching some of these guys' one rep maxes, but Neil's not going to be able to make those kind of mistakes if he wants to continue.
Neil Maddox, the oldest male competitor in the field. He is 30 7 years old. This is his sixth trip to the CrossFit Games. His best finish in 2013 when he was ninth.
Bye.
First semifinal heat underway. Con Porter, Neil Maddox, Bjorven Gudmundsson moving on to the second bar. Alex Anderson there as well. Now Neil Maddox in the blue shorts and no shirt. He is the first man to the third barbell. Maddox will clear that. Gudmundsson making his approach, as is Con Porter, but Maddox continues to lead the field behind. Chad McKay now onto the third bar. Maddox has the fourth bar up and over. One final bar for Neil Maddox.
And we knew he had the strength for this. It wasn't a matter of if he was strong enough, but I think the fact that the tempo slowed down is allowing him to set up better, be more calm, and then get the job done as he's walking through those bars, which he just walked right through them like they were all 135 pounds.
Neil Maddox wins this heat. Four other men still on the floor. Chad McKay out of Australia in the blue shirt comes in fourth place overall. He's over the finish line. Alex Anderson is in. Bjorven Gudmundsson is done. And now it's Con Porter, the man who finished second in the opening event on Wednesday. The horn has sounded for the time cap. And Neil Maddox is the heat winner. Remember, the top five times move on to the finals. They're going to let Con Porter go ahead and try to finish the ladder. He's still on the floor. 2 minute time cap. And Porter can't get under that. 20 seconds for Con Porter to make one more run. You can make multiple attempts. It doesn't matter how many tries you make. You just have to get one. And Porter's not going to be able to finish the semifinals. He has time for one more.
Good attempt. Good attempt. You got to figure what these guys have done up to this point as well. So it's not just this particular event. It's all the ones leading up to it and all the ones you have to deal with afterward.
Neil Maddox made methodical work here.
So impressive. I mean, I think the fact that he was able to walk to the bar, slowed his tempo down, slowed his whole mindset down, and then he can just do work, which is move heavy weights the way he moves them. He's so powerful.
Neil Maddox takes the heat, but it will remain to be seen if he will be one of the five men moving on to the winner-take-all final. When we did an event like this last year, Neil Maddox was in that final, and he has a time of 42.49, the second of four semifinal heats. Scott Panchik in lane number three needs to start scoring some points here.
He really does. I mean, starting from the bottom, that's just not where he wants to be. It's not where he's used to being. Granted, the first two events weren't necessarily the classic type of CrossFit movements or types of events, but it's time for him to start making a march towards the front if he wants to have a shot at that podium.
Scott Panchik will be out in the next heat. Lucas Parker, a man who can lift weights. The question is, can Lucas Parker lift them quickly?
Now, the last heat he did, and it was actually real impressive to see him just grab and go. Again, as the weights get heavier, he may have to set up a little bit more, so that's where it's going to be kind of interesting to see what happens.
The second of four heats, Nick Urankar in the middle of the floor. He can move weight, as can Lucas Parker. And then Cole Sager in lane five, his second year at the CrossFit Games, another powerful athlete in the field. That's Nick Urankar. Second heat underway. 220-pound bar is up and good. Nick Urankar, Ben Garrard, and Tyson Takasaki all got to that second bar first. They clear 230. Urankar, Garrard, and Takasaki on to 235. Garrard gets hit with a no rep. Urankar moves on with Takasaki. Takasaki in the blue. Urankar with no shirt. Takasaki will hit 240, as will Nick Urankar, and it's a battle between those two for first place in this heat. But Lucas Parker now making the approach to the 245-pound bar. Urankar has it up, and he will win this second of four semifinal heats. Tyson Takasaki is in, as is Lucas Parker. Cole Sager and Ben Garrard
left on the floor. It's a 2-minute time cap for the semifinal heats.
Nick Urenco, what was great about that was he was actually running from bar to bar. I don't want to say a run, but a jaunt from bar to bar, whereas Neil Maddox is walking. So that's going to play a difference in the time. Cole Sager, an extremely strong athlete. We've seen him do it in just other local type competitions where he's put up 265 pounds in a snatch. So again, I just think it's that combination of events going into this, and then just the anticipation of trying to keep those bars, get the bars up and keep them up.
Cole Sager will finish. Ben Garrard out of Australia. The last time he was doing an event like this was at regionals. It was 15 muscle-ups followed by a speed clean ladder, and he set the record on that event, and that was able to get him into the CrossFit Games because of that performance.
One of the things we hear about in the Olympic lifting world towards CrossFit is moving Olympic lifts, you know, doing the snatch of the clean and jerk for that one time. That's so much different than doing it for reps or doing it for speed, and here we are doing it for speed, and it's tough. It's a very technical movement, and your brain just has to be involved. You got to be correctly lined up mentally and physically to make that bar go up. And if it gets in your head, it can be detrimental.
Nick Urenkar will leave the floor victoriously. Lucas Parker, and this is the margin between a successful lift
and all it was,
and a no rep.
He was in the race, which is something we don't usually see Lucas Parker do, but he didn't stand up all the way. But wow. Nick Urenkar, so strong, quick through that, looks so powerful. And the fact that he was stepping forward, I think that's going to put him ahead of Neil Maddox.
And the former collegiate kicker turns in a time of 41.28 seconds. He's followed by a pair of Canadians, and then Cole Sager and Australian Ben Garrard rounding out the top five. Top five times out of all four of these heats, moving on to the winner-take-all final. The third of four semifinal heats. Scott Panjic in the middle of the floor. He's a man who came into this competition. Many thought that he could be the one who replaces Rich Froning on top of the podium. He's been struggling so far.
Has been struggling so far. Again, the CrossFit Games is a very long event, a very long competition, so he has a lot of points that he can make up. But he needs to start doing that now. He can't let himself get too bummed out about how things have been going and really put things together here. He is extremely strong, and he should do well in this event. Just needs to stay focused and make things happen.
Panjic, a former collegiate football player, currently sits 24th. John Para is one of the only athletes in this field who has a full-time job that's not a coach at a CrossFit affiliate. He's an officer with the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department.
I would not want to be a criminal that he's chasing. Man, he would scare me. I think he has a cape underneath his uniform.
Third of four semifinal heats in the snap speed ladder underway. Chad Melton in lane four clears 220. Melton in the gray shirt is through 230. Now to the 235-pound bar. He and John Para out front. Melton will hit that. Now on to 240. Para close behind as those two battle for the top spot. Melton on to 245 pounds, as is John Para. Melton will stand that up. John Para will stand that up, and the two of them,
impressive,
across the finish line. Scott Panjic will finish third. Travis Williams next to him, dumped it behind him. Now Aaron Hanna, two Games rookies left on the floor. Williams makes another run, he'll hit that. Hanna cannot. 1 minute to go before we hit the 2 minute time cap. Aaron Hanna can make as many attempts at this as he wants inside that 2 minutes. And Hanna will make it. So all five men inside the 2 minute time cap. It's Chad Melton, though, edging out John Para by just about 2 seconds. Melton hoping that was enough to get him into the finals.
So yes, he is a rookie. However, this is the stuff that he loves. He loves the heavy barbell work. There was a time a couple years ago where he said, I would just rather just do Olympic lifting. Well, guess what? Now you're doing Olympic lifting in a CrossFit setting, and he's so good at this. Look at how strong he is. Now, granted, he wasn't moving as fast as he needed to from bar to bar, as you saw like Nick Urenkar doing, but hopefully for him, I mean, because there wasn't any kind of struggles with the weights, hopefully that's going to get him into that final heat.
And let's not forget, all these athletes are doing this event mere hours after running 1 mile, doing 100 pull-ups, 200 push-ups, 300 air squats, and then running another mile in 20-pound body armor.
Yeah, these guys are tough. They're tough. But that's the event. That's the test. When you want to find the fittest of the fit, is you have to put them under some sort of duress like that, and that's what's happening here.
Chad Melton leads the way in the third of four semifinal heats. His time about 2 seconds better than second place John Parra, and Scott Panchik will finish third. Rory McKernan is on the competition floor. Let's send it down to him.
Sean, talking about the cumulative effect of these events, I was just underneath the StubHub Center watching the athletes who are coming off and going on, and unanimously it's their shoulders that are just burnt out. So Ben Garrard, for example, said he's actually surprised that he finished that round, considering it's a heavyweight for him and the state that his shoulders are in. The only man who seemed to be extremely confident was Nick Urankar, and you saw how he ran through those, so not too surprising to hear.
Thank you, Ro. The fourth and final semifinal heat. The top five moving on to the finals. And these are the men who had the fastest times in that initial quarterfinal heat. Elijah Muhammad was the fastest. He's in the middle of the floor. But look out for Matt Fraser in lane number one. Probably had the prettiest lifts of all.
So there's the man, Easy Muhammad. He basically might as well be synonymous with snatch in the CrossFit world. So fast, so powerful. He loves this movement, but the battle between him and Matt Fraser, I think, is just going to be absolutely epic in this heat.
Ben Smith on the floor as well. Smith coming in 13th place overall. He's only 25 years old, but this is his seventh trip to the CrossFit Games.
Ben Smith, you put a barbell in this guy's hands, and he's just unbelievable. So the field needs to watch out for him.
£220 out of the chute for all of these athletes. Elijah Muhammad clears it. Fraser's cleared it. Ben Smith and Spencer Hendel. Muhammad gets to the 235-pound bar first. And Elijah Muhammad once again leading the way. Here comes Ben Smith and Matt Fraser. Muhammad, though, with a no rep. That's going to open the door for Ben Smith to take the lead. And Matt Fraser's close behind. Elijah Muhammad now falls back into third. 2:45 for Ben Smith is good, and Ben Smith takes the final semifinal heat. Matt Fraser in second, Elijah Muhammad is third.
And we knew once we got to these heavier weights, this is what was going to happen. We saw Spencer Hendel a couple bars back, actually had a missed rep, had a no rep, and then it gets in your head. And as you see the rest of the field come across the finish line, you have that, oh my gosh, now what do I do? Kind of a moment. You got to be able to keep it together and march through these bars. We know these guys can do this wave.
1 minute to go for Spencer Hendel. Alex Vigneault also on the floor. Vigneault's going to hit that, and he will cross the finish line, leaving Spencer Hendel as the only athlete left on the competition floor in this final semifinal heat. Hendel's going to make another attempt at 245, and he will make it. So Spencer Hendel won't move on to the finals. But remember, he's competing against everybody else, and points are on the line here. Ben Smith is your winner, and he benefited from a no rep courtesy of Elijah Muhammad.
And that's exactly what he needed. Move nice and smooth. But you can see right here, Easy Muhammad. He was moving so fast, just got out of position. That left arm just started to buck a little bit. Matt Fraser was powerful and smooth all the way through. Saw him bobble once, two bars back from the final bar, but he moved so quick. Ben Smith.
Matt Fraser came in second overall. Yon Koski, the man who was in the lead, didn't make it to the semifinals. Matt Fraser looks like he's going to pass Yon Koski for the overall lead. Ben Smith wins the final semifinal heat with a time of 33.73 seconds. He's followed by Matt Fraser and Elijah Muhammad. The winner take all final is next as Fast and Heavy gets even heavier. Who will the final five be? We'll find that out when we come back. back at the StubHub Center in Carson, California, as the fourth event of the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games continues. I'm Sean Woodland alongside Bill Grundler. And Bill, the Fast and Heavier is now, Fast and Heavy is now getting even heavier.
It is heavier. That's right. Our five bars now have been loaded up to 250, 260, 265, 270, and ending at 275 pounds. And again, it's how fast can you get through this with a 3-minute time cap.
Rory McKernan is on the competition floor with more on the final heat of the Snatch Speed Ladder.
These men move so fast, we need some perspective. 250,000 people completed the Open. 125,000 of them were men. Of that group, only 420 could lift this weight one time. That's 1 in 1,000 people who could get this overhead once. These guys are doing it for time.
Thank you, Ro. And 275 pounds is the final weight on this ladder. These are the five fastest times from the semifinals, and it was Ben Smith in the middle of the floor who had the fastest. Matt Fraser, who has a background in Olympic lifting, is right next to him. But we're approaching the one rep max for a lot of the athletes in this field.
And it's not just about what's your one rep max. It's about how you're able to compose yourself to have that controlled speed and explosiveness, but being in position at the same time. This is such a technical movement, and that's what these guys all have to do if they expect to get through all five bars.
Elijah Muhammad was the fastest in the quarterfinals. Matt Fraser was a rookie last year at the CrossFit Games, finished second. He is the odds-on favorite to take the top spot on the podium in 2015. Elijah Muhammad, a Games rookie. John Para looking to score some points here. Winner take all, 250 up first.
You saw a whole different approach go to that first bar. Everyone walks to the bar. Again, this isn't necessarily about racing through it because you have 3 minutes, but they have to prep themselves for each one of these bars. Position is going to be imperative.
Matt Fraser in the orange shorts, Ben Smith in the blue sleeve shirt, and Elijah Muhammad all back to that 265-pound bar at the same time. Fraser missed, and now Muhammad and Smith strolling to the 270-pound bar. Fraser will clear 265, and John Para now joining the battle for the top spot. Ben Smith is through, and he will take the lead. And Ben Smith faces down the 275-pound bar. He hits this before anybody else. He wins the event, and he's 100 points richer.
So far up to that bar, he's the one that looked the most consistent and smooth in his arms. It's just so impressive, that pulling under.
John Para, 275. And John Para coming from behind, and he will win the Snatch Speed Ladder. Smith for second place. Ben Smith will get that. 94 points for Ben Smith. Elijah Muhammad hit himself in the head with the barbell, and he is on the floor. Adrian Bosman, the head judge, is coming over to check on Elijah. Elijah telling Adrian Bosman he's okay and just taking a second to collect himself. Meanwhile, Matt Fraser hits 270. The worst he can do right now is fifth place. Chad Melton has cleared 265. Melton will move on to 270, but nobody in a hurry right now. And Elijah Muhammad is leaving the competition floor. Meanwhile, Matt Fraser, 45 seconds to complete this lift. Wow. 275, good for Matt Fraser.
He made that one look louder than the other one.
Matt Fraser, to the cheers of this crowd, walking across the finish line, but Muhammad looks like he just needed to walk to collect his thoughts. He only has 30 seconds. That should be good enough for one more attempt at this. Chad Melton is moving on to the 275-pound bar.
I think he went to just go get his belt, get himself all fired up for this last lift.
The crowd behind Elijah Muhammad. Elijah Muhammad is in inside the 3-minute time cap, and he will lock up a fourth place finish. Chad Melton, the only man in the finals not to make it through the ladder, but it's John Para, the Los Angeles County Sheriff, who will win the fourth event of the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games, and he will get 100 points, and Para needed that. He came in 27th place overall, but this looked dangerous for Elijah Muhammad.
Well, you know, he did get underneath the bar. He, with the snatch, you have to commit, but collected himself, figured out what he needed to do, and he's just so powerful, because when he came back to the bar, look at that, solid.
John
Perry pretty happy about it too.
Cheering him on as Elijah Muhammad turned defeat into a pretty good victory. Ben Smith started to fail, and this is again at the uppermost limits for some of these athletes as far as what they can lift just for a one rep max. And then you put him in this setting, it becomes even more difficult.
Absolutely.
But it was John Para who was smooth and steady, took advantage of some of the mistakes of his competitors, and he will get the event win. And right now, he's with Nikki Brazier.
John, you cannot wipe the smile off of your face right now. Tell me what's going through your mind.
I can't even explain it. It's just an amazing feeling to come out here and get a victory. The fans are amazing. My family up there, love them.
That's great.
So it's just an awesome feeling.
That's great. Now, it's a very different feeling in the final heat here. You guys are walking up to the bar, taking a minute. What is going through your mind as you address those heavy, heavy barbells?
Just hit each bar like you hit it in the gym. Be focused, set up properly, and just have good technique and have fun.
And just win if you're you. Congratulations. A big win for you here, man. Great work.
The L.A. County Sheriff's Deputy, 100 points. Dishing out some justice on those barbells. 112.69, the winning time. He bests Ben Smith and Matt Frazier. The snatch speed ladder in the books for the men. Matt Frazier and Easy Muhammad in the final heat, but it was John Para who gets the victory. The women are up next.
We've gone long, and now it's time for the women of the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games to go very, very short with the sprint event in the Snatch Speed Ladder. Brandon Domain, Tanya Wagner with you here at the Tennis Stadium at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. And after a pretty monumental big moment event that we had earlier with Murph, the leaderboard definitely has shaken up a little bit.
Well, now it's time to see who can just recover quickly from that and see who can be quick and technical in the Snatch Speed Ladder. What these athletes are going to face is five bars as fast as they can. They'll have 1 minute to complete 110 pounds, 115, all the way through 130-pound bars as fast as they can in a complete squat snatch. The athletes that do so the fastest will move on in the next heat, and the weights will get increasingly heavier.
That cut will go from 39 athletes that are still here in the competition after Danny Horan withdrew before it to 20 after this round. The first four to take on the Snatch Speed Ladder will include Amanda Goodman in lane number two and Maddie Myers, somebody to keep an eye on, in lane number five.
Lane number five, Maddie Myers, 18 years of age, our youngest female competitor, stands at 5'2", 127 pounds, just competed in June in the Junior Worlds in Poland for Olympic lifting. This is a girl you want to keep your eye on.
A listed PR of 185 for Myers, a listed PR of 190 for Amanda Goodman.
Amanda Goodman is another solid athlete, especially on the technical lift. She is a gymnast and as her background, but she's just dominated the weights. Took second last year at the Clean Speed Ladder and first the year before the Phoenix Arc.
And round one of what could be the most exciting event of the weekend here in Carson now underway, and Amanda Goodman off to a great start. And cruising through a full bar ahead, Amanda Goodman already through three up to 125. One bar remains, and Amanda Goodman will be making quick work here in heat number one. Goodman good on the final rep and across the line. In right about 30 seconds, just under 29.93. Lindy Barber through, Jessica Kaur through, and Maddie Myers continues to stand on the start mat in lane number five.
And this is what we're assuming here, that we're guessing that she has an injury or there's something that she cannot move on. Because of the injury, it looks like they're going to have someone come out.
Well, for a event that should have been right in the wheelhouse for Maddie Myers, definitely something we didn't expect here.
So emotional for a rookie to have to go out there and stand there. So hard to be that, to handle the pressure as it is, and yet alone stand there and not move when especially it's your movement. That would have been her event. But it was Amanda Goodman, just great speed. She had solid technique all the way for every single bar. She had beautiful composure. To be able to sprint so quickly and then get yourself composed to the next heavier bar was perfect, well executed. She did it on the first five light bars, solid time, but it was her speed and composure that got her the win there in that first heat and giving the rest of the heats a time to shoot for.
That speed definitely on display, 29.93, the current time to beat after one of eight heats here in event number four, the Snatch Speed Ladder. For the second group of athletes going through, we do have somebody with pretty proficient skills with the barbell in lane number two, Elizabeth Akinwale.
She placed first last year at the Speed Clean Ladder. She is known for her heavy lifts. This is the event she's been looking forward to as soon as they announced that they were going to do a similar event to last year. Look for her to dominate this heat.
200 pounds, the personal best lift for Elizabeth Akinwale. Will be going over that. Somebody else very strong here in this heat will be in lane number one right next to her, Alessandra Pacelli.
Pacelli, another stronger athlete. She had an injury last year. We didn't have a chance to see everything she was capable of doing. This is her third year to the games and is healthy and another one to watch out for. She has great technique and is just a fighter. So with this snatch, you don't have a lot of room for error, but she has a lot of practice and has good skill. So anxious to see what she can put up.
Stand by.
Heat two underway in the quarterfinal round for the Snatch Speed Ladder. Elizabeth Akinwale, the first one to drop that opening bar at 110 pounds. And the first one to drop the second at 115. Akinwale in the lead. However, it's a close race behind her with Pacelli and Carol Ann Reason Tebow in lanes 1 and 5 bookending the floor. Akinwale with now one bar remaining. This is 130, still a very lightweight for her, and it shows. Elizabeth Akinwale won't be the new time to beat, but she will be the winner here in heat number one at 31.31. Carol Ann Reason Tebow just a quarter of a second behind, and Alessandra Pacelli in third.
I think the biggest thing for Pacelli was she was trying to match Akinwale's speed, and while she's a strong athlete, she just wasn't able to keep that pace with Akinwale as well.
And as Kelly Jackson crosses at just about 50 seconds, all five athletes able to beat that 1 minute time cap led by Elizabeth Akinwale.
For Akinwale, she snatched 196 pounds earlier this year at the regional. So for her, these weights are just the warm-up weights. Really, she can afford to be a little sloppy. She can pull that weight in. It'll be the heavier lift where you really see the technique come through for her.
As Akinwale looking like she was lifting a PVC pipe for much of this opening round that progressed from 110 to 130. She currently sits with the second fastest time, Amanda Goodman's earlier time of 29.93 seconds. Still the time to beat, not far ahead of your Heat 2 winner, Elizabeth Akinwale.
She just pulls herself under that bar so quickly, has a very good awareness of where that bar is going to be directly over her head. Just solid with the lockout.
So 31.31 for Akinwale is the heat winner, but it was only 27 hundredths of a second faster than runner-up Carol Ann Reason Tebow, who currently sits in the third position after two heats. In heat number three, definitely keep an eye on lane number three, Brooke Entz, with a listed PR of 205 pounds.
This girl is strong. Rookie out of California Regional. She is strong, looking for a good event. She came in with high expectations and a lot of people watching eyes on her for the rookie. But you know what? This is going to be the event to watch. She hasn't had things go her way as much, but this could be the event that turns things around for her.
And somebody that might be able to play a spoiler here, Jen Jones in lane number four.
Her fourth consecutive games. She is a gymnast, has a gymnastics background, but again, another very strong athlete, has always done well in the strength events.
Brooke Entz is a rookie, but she did become the champion of the California Regional, one of the toughest ones to come through to get here.
She's a fighter. She's gained a tremendous amount of strength the past year. She's ready to show it.
Stand by.
Heat three of eight underway, starting with 110 pounds. In a neck and neck race in the higher lanes, three through five, currently led by Brooke Entz. She's the first one to bar number three. 120 is good for Entz. She sets it down, and she's also the first one to 125, continuing to look very easy with these lifts. One bar remains at 130, and the California Regional Champion, Brooke Entz, will take heat number three and will do so with a new time to beat of 28.85 seconds. Nicole Holcomb in second. Jen Jones crosses the line in third. Helga Dotter in fifth. And Becca Voigt, making her eighth consecutive games appearance, will round out heat number three at 39.29 seconds.
That smile tells it all, but you know, it was really, she looked like a veteran here. She, not only the way she lifted so technical and sound, but really the way when the barbell dropped, the way she was able to control that bounce. And we've seen in the past with the clean speed ladder last year at the regionals, people would trip over that barbell. Very smart. Watch the way Brooke holds the bar, make sure it stays on the ground, steps over nicely. And it was that wherewithal, knowing where the bar was, that helped her not get tripped up and just was able to do her thing on every single barbell.
Brooke Entz, after three of eight heats, the new time to beat for the number one spot, 28.85 seconds, almost 2 seconds ahead of Nicole Holcomb, who took second. Jen Jones, looking like she may be safe in that top 20 that will advance to the second round at 32.44. Here in heat number four, another pair of strong, strong athletes. In lane number four, the reigning champ, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet, and also in lane number one, a rookie, Brooke Wells.
Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet coming in 22nd place today. She's definitely looking to end today better than she's coming in. So she needs a big, big lift, fast lift. She's able to do that. She's gotten stronger every year, really has shown what she can do. The biggest thing for Camille is what she can do mentally. Can she handle the pressure? If she gets tripped up, watch for her to be able to pull herself together, or will she fall apart? That's what I'm looking for, as this is the second event of the day for her.
The defending women's champion, not often we've seen her outside of the top 20 in the point standing. Still early, several tests remain for Camille LeBlanc-Fazinet.
With a listed snatch of 200 pounds, she is absolutely capable of doing well, of lifting these bars. But again, this is a different beast. We're going quickly through the bars. You have to hurry up and then get yourself composed.
Also in that 200-pound PR club, Brooke Wells, the rookie.
She's a strong athlete. She was the fifth athlete out of the Atlantic region, East region, to come over here at rookie to the games, but another dominant athlete that I expect to see a lot of confidence out of in this event.
Heat four underway. Keep your eyes. Wells in gray and orange. LeBlanc-Fazinet in white. And Camille LeBlanc-Fazinet sets it down. No reps now twice on the opening bar. And Camille is in severe danger of advancing to round two.
Oh, that is so upsetting for Camille.
Carlene Matthews and Alethea Boone are leading the way in what is going to be a huge upset, as Camille, no reps again. Alethea Boone out of Australia will take the heat. 29.44 for Boone, the number two time to beat. Carlene Matthews is across. Brooke Wells is across, leaving Alex Parker and Camille LeBlanc-Fazinet on the floor. And Camille showing the emotion as she crosses the line and very likely will not advance to the semis.
And that's a lot of emotion. That's so upsetting. She has, in the past, has had trouble with depth at times. And I think that's just, the weight was actually so light for her. I think she was going so quick that the depth was the issue. But Alethea Boone, surprise, I am shocked right now, has a gymnastic background, is coming off of a lot of great energy from the event prior, taking second. But here is Camille LeBlanc-Fazinet just trying to go for her judges, saying you're just not low enough, you got to get deeper. And emotionally, that is just hard to come back from. Each one, these are not heavy barbells for her, but Alethea Boone really stuck each one, made sure she made each one count. Very impressive for this rookie. Took second place overall in this ladder. Very impressive time for a rookie, not what I expected at all.
How about that? The woman in the field with the lowest listed snatch PR, Alethea Boone, with the second fastest time thus far through four heats here in the snatch speed ladder at 29.44 seconds.
And see, that's just it, Brandon. For these athletes, if the fast ones with the lighter weights can knock out those girls that have the heaviest posted snatch, then they're just helping themselves out. So really, it comes down to the leaderboard, who can snatch quickly light, but then who also has it in the tank to go heavy.
And when we were looking at these heat sheets, this to me is standing out as the possible star of this competition here in the quarterfinals. Heat five, Lindsay Valenzuela in lane number four. Also very strong lifters in lane two and one with Sammy Wood and Emily Abbott, but Valenzuela in that 200-pound club.
There's a reason that Valenzuela is called Lift Like Lindsay. I mean, this is her thing. She's going to excel here. Just watch, as long as she can maintain her composure. But she excels and loves when she does well, and the faster she can go, the better she's going to get.
Stand by.
Away we go with heat number five, 28.85, the current top time set by Brooke Entz. In heat number three, Lindsay Valenzuela in lane number four, currently leading the way, but getting a hard charge from Emily Abbott in white and orange in lane number five on the near side of the screen. It's a four-way race as they get to bar number four. And Cassidy Lance in lane number one on the right side of the screen will take it at just about 28 seconds. And she has set a new time to beat of 28.35. Sammy Wood just 2 seconds behind. Lindsay Valenzuela at 31.4. Abbott at 32. And Perry Pierce in at 39.45. And she's going to be on that bubble line on possibly advancing to the semis herself.
Cassidy Lance came out of nowhere. This is her third games and said she is here this year to take it. This, she's going to show us what she has. She has a listed PR snatch of 176 pounds, but man, it was the speed that she moved through these early bars that really set her up nicely for the end, and she actually got faster with each bar. She was the fastest overall after five heats with 28.35 seconds. It was because of that speed on those early bars and the nice composure.
Cassidy Lance with the new time to beat, 28.35 here in the opening round of the Snatch Speed Ladder. 20 athletes will advance to the semifinals. So currently being led by Lance, 28.35 seconds as we get ready for heat number six. And this should also be a good one with a couple of favorites entering the competition. Emily Bridgers in lane number one and two-time champ Annie Thorisdottir in lane number five.
And there's some spectators dressing up nicely. We said it's hot in here. People are looking out for their skin. Just some use sunscreen, some just cover all the way up.
Can never be too safe away from sunburn, as on show there in the crowd. And the athletes now taking the floor here for heat number six. Annie Thorisdottir with that traditional smile that she always seems to have, even after recovering from some heat-related issues in Murph, unable to finish within that 55-minute time cap, but she is back out here on the floor, her sixth appearance, twice a champion.
And for Annie right now, you know, she's just thinking, going through the moves is what she does, one to the next. Katrin Davidsdottir, we missed her at last year, didn't make it to the games, but she is back, another strong athlete. She's been training with Annie Thorisdottir over the past year, and it's just been tremendous for her training and her abilities coming into this year's games.
Heat six underway, two remaining after this one. And this is a star-studded heat, currently being led in lane number two by Katrin Tanya Davidsdottir, but everybody within a couple of seconds of each other as they get to the middle bar at 120 pounds. Davidsdottir continues a slight lead over Emily Bridgers at the top of the screen. 125, good for both of them. Katrin Tanya Davidsdottir, the first to the final bar at 130. She's under it, stands it up, sets it down, and Katrin Tanya Davidsdottir will take the heat. Emily Bridgers in second, Annie Thorisdottir in third, and a trip for Whitney Yellen, the rookie out of the Atlantic Regional. She'll wind up in fifth in this heat, and that was a costly slip-up that might keep her outside of the top 20.
But Katrin just looked smooth each and every bar, impeccable form. Her technique was spot on. That's going to bode well for going into these later heats. The better practice you can have with those early weights, it just sets your body up ready for the heavier lifts. Beautifully done.
Two heats remain. Katrin Tanya Davidsdottir now with the fifth fastest time thus far, 30.23.
And that final lift at the top of your screen, beautiful. She drove out of the bottom of that squat so nicely, kept a nice vertical torso. Every lift looks the same. And again, has learned her lesson. Make sure that you keep your hands on the bar so you don't trip over those barbells as you run across. It was that form, though, that helped her get through those so quickly and take that heat.
Katrin Tanya Davidsdottir currently with the fifth fastest time at 30.23. Emily Bridgers, Annie Thorisdottir also looking pretty safe for that top 20 cut line as they were both in under 34 seconds. Heat number seven, the next to last one, and we can definitely keep an eye on lane number two, Michelle Latondra, one of the favorites entering the competition this year.
Michelle Latondra, this is her fifth consecutive games. She started CrossFit back in 2010, so she has just improved every year she's been to the games. Starting in 2011, she was 25th, and all the way up to last year, just missing the podium, taking fourth. And she is hungry for it every year. Mentally, she just gets stronger. That was her one thing, and she has gotten stronger both physically and mentally. Her best finish so far at the games has been second place at the pier paddle, and she is able to go quick.
Latondra, who absolutely ran away with the East Regional to get here to Carson this year. Another threat, though, here in heat number seven, and that would be Margot Alvarez out of the South Regional.
She has a posted snatch of 180 pounds, but again, for this first particular quarterfinal, it's going to be these lighter weights, and she can move quickly. I expect to see her do very well.
Yeah. Heat 7 underway. Just one remains after this one. Michelle LaTondra, incredibly quick lift at 110. She has a slight lead in purple on the left side of the screen. She'll be making her way to the third bar, as does everybody else. Nobody has missed a lift thus far as we get to the 125 bar. It is nearly a three-way tie for the lead as Michelle LaTondra, with just ahead as she gets to the final bar, stands it up. And Michelle LaTondra with a new time to beat. 27.54 for Michelle LaTondra. Tia Claire Toomey at just over 29 seconds. China Cho at 31. Danae Brown 33. And Margot Alvarez still under 34 seconds in a very, very fast heat.
Awesome speed and great confidence from Michelle LaTondra. She is 5'1", so that being a little shorter in the field that she was against really helped her with those other ladies, because she didn't have it. She could stand up a lot quicker, but man, she moved with confidence. She got after each and every bar, treated everyone like it was heavy, got after it, and really didn't have too many bobbles at all. Nice, quick, choppy steps to get to the next bar, got herself composed.
So fast, she even had time to adjust her sunglasses a couple of times. Michelle LaTondra, the new top time, 27.54 seconds. And that is the fastest heat we've seen top to bottom thus far, with just one heat remaining. All five look to be in position to move on to the semifinals, where we go from 39 to 20. And the final heat featuring the top five in the points standings, Anna Tunnicliffe, the points leader, will be in lane number three. And Cara Webb, she had those difficulties during Murph, definitely heat-related. We're wondering what we're going to get out of Cara Webb at this point, if she's even going to be out on the floor.
Well, she came into today's games in first place, only went down to second place coming into this event. Again, she does not need to take the top. She just needs to do well enough that she doesn't let too much slip away. Anxious to see what she's capable of doing here. But she will be against some strong athletes that can definitely put up some big numbers of fast times. There she is with her smile, looking a lot better now. She got herself recovered what she needed to do, and just anxious to see what happens out here for her.
Cara Webb has the highest lift of anybody in the field. Sam Briggs, not the case there, but somebody that you can never count out of, especially with the lighter weights here in the opening round.
These early rounds are going to be Briggs.
So Sam Briggs looking to win a title here on her first time back to Carson after missing to the games in 2014, the 2013 champion here in the final heat. Heat 8 of 8 now underway. It starts at 110 pounds, and Anna Tunnicliffe, the first one through that first bar and on to 115, just ahead of Sarah Sigmund's daughter on the near side of the screen. Tunnicliffe in lane number three in the black top, struggling at 120, but she will stand it up. It opens the door for Sigmund's daughter to take the lead on bar number four. She's good at 125. It will make her way to 130 with a slight lead over Sam Cara Webb. Sigmund's daughter is through at 32 seconds. Cara Webb is in, Anna Tunnicliffe in. Two athletes remain, Kristen Holte and Sam Briggs. Holte is across, and Sam Briggs in severe danger of missing the cut going to the semifinals.
For Briggs, that was going to be the fastest she could go. That was going to be her heat if she was going to take it. So we're just going to see what shakes out there on the leaderboard for the times. But Sarah Sigmund's daughter, rookie from the Meridian region, took that region first place. And she is just showing us that she can come here under the pressure and just hang with the big girls. I'm really anxious to see as the weights get heavier how she does. Briggs here, you can see that her first fail, she just fell back, lost her balance. And once it got away from her there, she just couldn't catch up. She just doesn't have the speed that the other girls had to even make up that time.
And that could be very, very costly for the 2013 champion. It looks like she will be out going to the semifinal. Somebody that's definitely in, though, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, 32.31 seconds.
This might be her first year, but it sure doesn't look like it. And we're only going to see greater things as the weights get heavier. Want to see how she holds herself against the rest of the field.
So we will cut the field down from 39 to 20 as the semifinals around the corner here at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. We'll find out who advances to the finals next when we come back.
Entertainment capital of the world is now the fitness capital of the world. Back inside the tennis stadium at the StubHub Center in Carson, California, I'm Sean Woodland alongside 2009 CrossFit Games champion Tanya Wagner. 39 women started on the ladder, 20 are still climbing. The weights get heavier in the snatch speed ladder.
The mistakes are going to be more costly here because the weights have gone up. We're now going to see bars ranging from 135 pounds all the way up to 155 pounds. That final bar will be where we see things start to fall apart.
20 women remain. We will have five each in four semifinal heats. the fastest five times out of those four heats, advanced to the winner take all final, and the only woman to win two CrossFit Games championships, Annie Thoris' daughter, in this heat. First semifinal heat underway, 135 pounds on that first barbell. Margo Alvarez is through, Danae Brown, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Jen Jones, and Annie Thoris all clear it. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, the rookie out of Iceland in the orange top, she's the first to 145. She will clear that, as will Jen Jones and Annie Thoris' daughter. Two Icelanders and an American. Sigmund's daughter is through. Here come Jones and Thoris' daughter right behind her. Sigmund's daughter will hit that lift, and Sarah Sigmund's daughter takes the first heat, and it's a dead finish between Annie Thoris' daughter and Jen Jones.
What a race. That was awesome.
Jen Jones by 5/100ths of a second over Annie Thoris' daughter. Again, the fastest five times moving on out of these four heats. Margo Alvarez and Danae Brown, the two women left on the floor. Alvarez on the right, she will hit 150. Danae Brown, chalk up her hands, is returning to her bar.
These athletes have 2 minutes to get these five bars completed, and they are competing against the other three heats. We saw with the men, things start to fall apart at the final bars, so it's really important that they make each and every lift. They cannot afford to miss lifts, or they could run out of time.
Danae Brown out of Australia giving a little cheer. She got past 150. Margo Alvarez finishing up. Less than 30 seconds to go for Danae Brown at 155 pounds.
She probably won't have enough time to make another attempt. She may, but I don't think she had enough rest time.
Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet and Carl Webb did not make the cut. Webb just missed. She was 21st. The top 20 moved on. Danae Brown's not going to be able to clear 155.
And 150 is the listed snatch PR that she has. It is her current max, so she should be happy to be able to hit that out here in competition on a day when she's already done so much.
Jen Jones just holding off Annie Thoris' daughter. Say every second counts, but now it's every hundredth of a second counts.
That's what comes down to. Chip timing is awesome. Know which foot you have the chip on. Awesome foot race there. It wasn't the speed on the bar, it was how fast they could sprint across the line that did it for Jen Jones. But Sarah Sigmund's daughter, from the first bar to the last, she was the fastest one. Could just pull herself under that bar so quickly. She had such speed on the bar, every single one. Even though the bar got heavier, it really didn't look that way.
Sarah Sigmund's daughter by about a second over Jen Jones, who barely beat Annie Thoris' daughter. Margo Alvarez was able to finish, but Danae Brown missed the last barbell. Second of four semifinal heats in lane number two. Lindsay Valenzuela, and in lane four, Elizabeth Akinwale, and these women love the barbells.
I love that they're in the same heat because I expect to see them push against each other.
Elizabeth Akinwale making her fifth appearance at the CrossFit Games. She's finished inside the top 10 twice. She was seventh in 2012 and then 10th in 2013. And she won the clean speed ladder that we had here last CrossFit Games.
Not only do we know she can lift heavy, but she can do it quickly.
Lindsay Valenzuela, another woman with an Olympic lifting background.
Had she been here last year, I know she would have put pressure on Akinwale for that first place finish.
Second semifinal heat. Sarah Sigmund's daughter with the top time so far, 36.91 seconds. Elizabeth Akinwale in the blue top, tearing through 135. No problem at 140. Lindsay Valenzuela, a step ahead of her. Emily Abbott in the orange pants is on the outside. She is keeping pace. Akinwale and Valenzuela to 150 at the same time. Akinwale is first to 155, but here comes Valenzuela. Akinwale, no problems. And Elizabeth Akinwale takes the second semifinal heat. Lindsay Valenzuela is in second, and here comes Emily Abbott. Emily Bridgers hits 155. She's across, and it's Carol Ann Reason Tebow, the only woman left on the floor.
And you shouldn't always go at the pace that your heat is going. You have to know yourself, know your capabilities. For Carol Ann Reason Tebow, it's just going to be important for her to get as far as she can in this, because your placements will be dictated on how far you get.
One of the great things about CrossFit, the man or woman who is last on the floor often gets more cheers than the man or woman who finishes first. And this crowd is 100% behind Carol Ann Reason Tebow.
And it sure does help you make a lift. You hear their cheers, and it feeds you.
40 seconds for Carol Ann Reason Tebow to hit two more barbells, the first 150 pounds. Hack and Wally conferring with Lindsay Valenzuela. The two of them have the top times right now out of two heats.
If she can make this lift, it would be a PR for her. She has a lifted snatch at 145 pounds.
15 seconds before we hit the two-minute time cap, and Carol Ann Reason Tebow will not finish this, but she can set a new personal best if she hits this. And Carol Ann Reason Tebow, a moral victory. She sets a PR in front of a packed house here at the tennis stadium at the Stub Up Center. She won't advance.
Hey, in my opinion, that is the best way to do it. That is what the game is all about. Let's find out what these athletes have.
We see some great moments on the tennis stadium floor when some athletes kind of go beyond their capacity. This crowd definitely has a positive effect.
It was a neck and neck tie there for Akinwale and Valenzuela, but on the 150 bar, Lindsay lost the balance just a little bit. Super impressive, a testament to her strength that she was able to hold on to that. But those few steps back cost her even more steps to that final 155-pound bar. And that's where Akinwale was able to step in and just clobber that 155-pound bar, taking the win.
Elizabeth Akinwale sets the new fastest time. Sarah Sigmund's daughter had it before that, but Akinwale bests it by about 4 seconds. Lindsay Valenzuela finishing second in the heat. But when we bring out the heavy barbells, that's when Elizabeth Akinwale likes to go to work. Emily Abbott will finish in third, followed by Emily Bridgers and Carol Ann Reason Tebow, the only woman in that heat to fail to complete all five barbells. The third of four semifinal heats coming up. Another woman who does well at the heavy barbells, right in the middle of the floor. That's Amanda Goodman. Also keep an eye on the woman from Iceland, Katrin David's daughter. The top five times move on to the finals. David's daughter, one of four women from Iceland to take the five qualifying spots out of the Meridian Regional. It was one of eight regionals that sent athletes here to the CrossFit Games.
Her third time to the CrossFit Games. Showing us what she has this year. And again, Amanda Goodman just has the speed for these barbells. She is one of the shorter athletes, so she's able to pull herself under even that much quicker, stand up that much faster.
Amanda Goodman won the clean and jerk ladder at the games in 2013. She can lift big weight.
Took second last year at the speed clean ladder, so it shows that she can move quickly as well.
The third semifinal heat is underway. The 135-pound barbell is in the books for every athlete. Amanda Goodman in the middle of the floor will hit 140, but it's Katrin David's daughter who gets to 145 just ahead of Nicole Holcomb and Amanda Goodman. David's daughter on the left of your screen in the blue top. She and Nicole Holcomb on the left side fighting for first place. Holcomb will hit 155. David's daughter will hit 155. It's a race to the finish. And it's Nicole Holcomb just finishing ahead of David's daughter.
Holcomb very quick to move. I was afraid she was going to trip up on that last bar, but she was nice and smooth on that. She was able to get out of the bottom of that spot a little bit faster. She gave her the time there to get across the line.
China Cho out of the California Regional will hit 155, and she will finish. Sammy Wood out of Australia, the only woman left on the floor. She just completed her lift at 150, so one barbell remains for Sammy Wood.
But as China Cho celebrates there, I am so impressed with her games so far. Came in today in fourth place. She is just having an awesome games. She was even better last year than when we saw her in 2010. Has just trained so hard.
Sammy Wood will complete the snatch speed ladder as she makes 155 pounds, but that will not get her into the top five. But she is still competing against the 38 other women in the field. It was Nicole Holcomb who would finish in third place.
And she was smooth through every barbell. It was the way she got out of the bottom of the squat snatches. That was why she was able to take the win over David's daughter. They were neck and neck, but as the weights got heavier, David's daughter, just her back would just lose. She would get a little more forward. Wasn't as vertical as Holcomb was able to stay. Watch how vertical she is in her squat in the bottom. Chest stays tall, and her chest rises with her hips. A little more balanced. It was still a foot race, but she was able to get in just before David's daughter.
Pardon me, Nicole Holcomb finishing first, and she did so well that she now has the best time. The top five women out of these four semifinal heats move on to the winner-take-all final. Sprinting across the finish line just before our Katherine David's daughter, Holcomb's time of 31.7 is now the top time out of the three heats. David's daughter's behind her, followed by Amanda Goodman, China Cho, and then Sammy Wood, who was the last woman on the floor but was able to complete a lift of 155 pounds. The fourth and final heat, these are the top times from the quarterfinal round. Michelle LaTondra in the middle of the floor, right next to Brooke Entz, and those are two women who should blitz through these barbells.
LaTondra was just feisty and fast, but Brooke Entz's confidence is going to be going against LaTondra's feistiness. Lance was solid. Boone was just sneaky, came out of nowhere. This is going to be a fast heat. We're going to see some ladies move quick.
Brooke Entz, the rookie out of the California Regional, out of CrossFit West in Santa Cruz, California. She was the only woman to win her regional without winning a single event. That's a testament to her consistency as an athlete.
But in order for her to get to the next final, she's going to have to be as long as with any of these ladies under 35.72 seconds. And Alethea Boone, a woman that had surprised me in the last heat, that she was able to come out of nowhere. Really anxious to see if she can handle that as the weights get heavier here, if she can maintain that speed.
She has experience competing on an international stage. Last heat of the semifinals, 135 right out of the gates. Michelle LaTong clears that first. Brooke Entz and Cassie Lancer right behind her. LaTong will be the first to clear 145. Entz and Lance battling for second. LaTong through 150 pounds. And Michelle LaTong at 150 will clear that.
She is feisty, on fire. That was awesome.
Brooke Entz sprints across the finish line. Cassie Lance, Tia Toomey, and Alethea Boone, the only woman left. Michelle LaTong and Brooke Entz with the two fastest times we've seen so far as Boone struggles with 155.
And this is just it. Now, as the weight gets heavier, there is a wall where the girls are going to hit that at some point. So your girls have not listed a little lower on the snatch PR. Maybe they can handle that speed early on, but this is really where it's catching up to them.
Cassidy Lance got called back to her barbell, so she's still on the floor at 155. Lance can't hit that.
And this is where it's costly, because as soon as you have a missed lift, you use and expended all that energy. She's looking for the crowd to help her out. She needs some help here.
Almost had it, just could not stand it up.
Her shoulders are fatigued now. Now it's going to be, this is willpower. She wants to get this. She has time to do so. She really should just take a little bit more time.
15 seconds before we hit the 2 minute time count. And on her final attempt, Cassidy Lance, with seconds to spare, will make it across the finish line. But it's that woman, Michelle LaTong, who sets the time to beat the best time we've seen in the semifinals at 28.51 seconds.
And that was 7 seconds faster than the fastest time in all of these four semifinal heats. Cassidy Lance took the barbell off her head there, had to recover, regroup a little bit, made about two or three more attempts before she finally did make that. But Michelle LaTong, each bar, just feisty and got after it. That run so quick, and then got herself composed for each and every barbell. And it was that composure and that feistiness that made her get all the way through. celebrating with their competitors that are happy for her as well.
Brooke Entz giving Michelle Letton a hug, and the two of them will be headed to the finals. Tia Claire Toomey, Cassidy Lance all get in. Lance with just a couple seconds to spare, and Alethea Boone fails to complete the semifinal of the Snatch Speed Ladder. It's winner take all, and that woman going for 100 points, as is the super rookie from Iceland. Elizabeth Akinwale showing us how it's done. The finals up next at the Step Up Center in Carson, California. Down to the final heat. You want to win, you got to be fast, but you're also going to have to be extremely strong. Sean Woodland alongside 2009 CrossFit Games champion Tanya Wagner, and things just got even heavier.
Things got heavier, and it's going to be more costly. Every mistake, it's going to be really important that each of these women know what they can handle as they approach barbells that weigh 160 pounds, 165, 170, all the way through 180 pounds. They have 3 minutes to get these barbells snatched in a squat snatch as fast as they can.
The final five, two rookies, three veterans. The vets, Akinwale, Holcomb, and Letton. The rookies, Brooke Entz and Catherine David's daughter, excuse me, one rookie, four vets. Brooke Entz, the only rookie. Michelle Letton out of Canada East, a former competitive swimmer and water polo player, her fifth trip to the CrossFit Games.
Coming in today in 14th place, but after an earlier performance in Murph, has bumped up the leaderboard to eighth, taking that momentum into this final event. Brooke Entz, your rookie out of the California region, showing that she came here to play. She didn't just come here for fun, and this is the event that's showing us that. Nicole Holcomb surprising us a little bit here with the barbells. Kind of came out of nowhere for us. A strong competitor, really focused here in this snatch bead ladder. Katrin David's daughter showing us that she is stronger. She's trained a really hard year with Annie Thor's daughter, and she is ready. And of course, Elizabeth Akinwale, the woman we associate with the heaviest weights and then the events that are strong.
160, the first barbell. Winner take all, 100 points on the line. Brooke Entz will be first to 165, but Nicole Holcomb, Katrin David's daughter, and Elizabeth Akinwale are right behind her. Entz moving on to 170 pounds, but here comes David's daughter and Holcomb. Holcomb will hit that. It's Entz and Holcomb to 175 pounds. David's daughter and Akinwale behind them, and Holcomb will miss her first attempt. Brooke Entz in the orange will hit that, and Brooke Entz, she clears 180. Her max is 205, will have 100 points in her pocket. Entz can't hang on to that, but she still has time because none of her fellow competitors have joined her at 180, but that's going to change as Nicole Holcomb just hit that. David's daughter trying to hang on. She will stand that up, as will Elizabeth Akinwale. Brooke Entz has company on that final barbell. Entz set up for her second attempt. David's daughter set up for her first. And Brooke Entz will hit that. And the rookie gets her first career victory at the CrossFit Games. David's daughter, second, followed by Nicole Holcomb.
Very impressive for Brooke Entz. She just used that momentum from every bar and got more and more confident. Even after a failed attempt, was able to take that win.
Elizabeth Akinwale finishing up as the crowd salutes the rookie Brooke Entz from the California Regional. Michelle Latton, the only woman left on the floor. David's daughter congratulating Brooke Entz. Michelle O'Connor is stuck at fifth place. She's not going to do any better or any worse, but she still wants to hit this lift and put on a show for the fans.
She did have the least amount of rest out of all the ladies since she did go last in the previous heat.
And she will get 175. One barbell remains for Michelle O'Connor, who will finish fifth in this event. The crowd at the tennis stadium at the StubHub Center coming to their feet. Brooke Entz trying to coach Nicole up a little bit. Now she's having some fun trying to get the crowd into it again. She's in fifth place. She won't do any worse than that. Making a run at 180 pounds. Michelle finishes that up, and every woman in the finals completes the snatch speed ladder, and event four for the women is in the books.
And that was a beautiful display of strength right there by Michelle Latton. But it was Brooke Entz who just ripped through each and every bar with confidence and was stronger on every bar. She even had a fail on that second to last barbell at 175. You can see she sets up, but it was when she went to catch it, she just wasn't able to hold on. Made it again, took another attempt, made it again, and she was on her way. David's daughter didn't have any failed attempts, she just went a little slower. And there's Brooke's final lift. So strong, she is celebrating before she even lets go of that barbell.
Brooke Entz has a listed max snatch of 205 pounds. And she was waiting for this event, and she is pumped up. She gets her first career win at the CrossFit Games, and she's standing by with Nikki Brazier.
Brooke, this may be your rookie year here, but you handled that event like a seasoned professional. Tell me what was going through your mind as you approached those barbells.
I had no choice. You know? I've been committing to have a really great time, but still play to win, and I needed that. For me and for my numbers, so.
Well, it was wonderful watching you get that, especially that last lift. Tell me how you're feeling going into your next event here, DT.
You gotta go, you know? You don't have a choice. It's gonna hurt, and what I got told is I will feel fine 10 minutes after that workout, so don't hold back.
It's a mantra we should all adopt. Congratulations here, your first game's win. Great job.
Brooke Entz, the rookie from the California Regionals, smiling about that victory. She loves the barbells, and this proves it. She edges out Catherine David's daughter, Nicole Holcomb. Will finish third, followed by Akin Wally and Michelle Lejandra. Event four in the books at the StubHub Center in Carson, California. Catherine David's daughter and Brooke Entz facing off in the final heat. And it's the California girl who comes out on top. The rookie pocketing 100 points for all the latest results. Games.CrossFit.com.
Many of us thought Woodwin does incredible, takes third place, and Elijah Muhammad put on one heck of a show as well. But Katie, I know somebody jumped out at you that maybe didn't have the best event.
Yeah, Janikowski, he was in the lead, but I think we've all talked about, you know, he started out the week really well, but, you know, heaviest barbell seemed to be his weaker point. He failed at 215 three times, and his PR coming in was 237, so dropped him from first to fourth. I think, you know, going into tonight, we'll see how he recovers.
And a gentleman who's just built like a G.I. Joe action figure, you know, had an event that, I mean, we knew he was strong, but I don't think we knew he was going to be the winner.
Yeah, kind of surprising in an event where there was a final field of four other lifters that had a posted snatch of 300 pounds or better. John Pair comes out of nowhere in lane number one to take the event victory, while all the other big names like Elijah Muhammad and Ben Smith and Matt Fraser were kind of pushing the pace and failing reps near the end towards those last two barbells in particular. Pair was methodical, precise. He smoked that final 275-pound barbell, you know, and that just happens to be 5 pounds less than his posted one rep max snatch, so he showed how confident he is, even getting close up to his 100%.
And I would have to think that his one rep is maybe a bit higher based upon the performance that he just showed to us. And 100 points is just what John needed. Let's see how, after four events total, the overall leaderboard looks here 2 days into the competition. Matt Fraser
in the lead by 58 points already. I mean, I don't know if it's too close to say that the train's already heading down the tracks, but with a heavy DT coming up, yeah, I don't know. Then we've got Goodmanson in second, Chad McKay, the big Australian, keeps there in the top three, incredibly impressive, and Ben Smith making his way to fifth really just won me over.
Yeah, I think Ben Smith, we talked about him on Wednesday. He did not finish under the cap for the sandbag event, and he was in 13th coming in, but we all know he likes to lift heavy barbells and did a very good job here. He went from 13th place all the way up to fifth, and I have to say he's probably going to do very well in DT tonight.
But is it too close to say, you know, that this thing's locked up?
You know, I don't want to jinx him and say that it is.
Go right ahead.
You know, Matt Fraser is confirming why all of us think that he is the heir to the throne, you know, heading into this year. First place, 58 points ahead of second. After a respectable 12th in the beach, he rattles off three straight top three finishes. He's the only male to finish in the top five in both Murph and the Snatch. And that last 275-pound barbell, the way he just dropped it and walked towards the finish line looking up to the crowd is kind of like a statement, you know, like, I'm here to win, and you know what? No one's going to take it from me.
And we're sitting here just watching these guys lift, but you got to remember how devastating Murph was. It just blows my mind the weights they are still putting up. Justin Judkins caught up with Matt Fraser after the snatch speed ladder.
Here with Matt Fraser, and you just took third on that last event. That moves you into the overall lead. How does that affect you mentally going forward from here on out?
It won't change a thing. Won't look at the leaderboard. Just keep taking it one event at a time, and it's not over till Sunday.
Last word I got was that it probably is going to be heavy DT. So as you prepare for that mentally, what's the game plan going into that event?
I don't know. I've never done heavy DT, and we've done a lot of work so far today, so we're going to just have to get out there, feel how the bar feels, and just go by that.
Can you explain what the experience is like to be in that tennis stadium with the crowd going nuts like it was?
It doesn't compare to anything. It makes bars feel light. It makes the pain in your legs go away. It's exciting.
Well, great job. Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right, now let's go to check out how the women shook out at the end of event four, the snatch speed ladder. Brooke Entz, the exciting rookie in first place, just moving weight and doing it quickly. Katrin David's daughter did exactly what she needed to do. And then Nicole Holcomb, no stranger to the barbell as well. And Elizabeth Akinwale getting some points on the board, very, very much needed. But Katie, again, somebody that we thought maybe this would be one of the events to help her get out of the hole. That's not what happened.
No, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet was in 22nd coming into this, and we thought she would do well, and I think she started to rush a little bit. 110 pounds is not a heavy weight for her, but she failed. She got no rep on her first two snatches and started to get frustrated. And mentally, that's really hard to recover from for an athlete, especially in the first round. Very frustrating for her. I think she'll do well in DT, but she has to recover tonight.
She has to do well on DT. Now, on the flip side of the coin, I mean, Camille is never out. I mean, if you're a former champion and you know this yourself, I mean, she can do it all. She's having a bad game thus far, but we've seen epic comebacks from people far down the leaderboard. So I think all she needs to do, she has her work cut out for her, but just keep showing up to every event and don't ever think that it's over until that final time is called on Sunday afternoon. On the other side of the coin, your training partner had, you know, a heck of a day.
Yeah, I picked her to win the event, and she's making me look good. It's my sister from another Mr. Brooke Entz. I mean, it's such a high-pressure situation. The movement and the format of this workout leaves little room for error. For her to step up and win is absolutely huge. The composure on the last bar after missing a rep, knowing where the rest of the athletes were to take her time and make sure she drilled that last one, couldn't be more stoked for her. A massive performance for her to try and move up the leaderboard. And I think she owes me some donuts after winning that event.
And well, I hope to see a battle between Brooke and between Camille on the next event that's coming up, and that is heavy DT. Both those women are very talented with the barbell. And event five looks like this. 5 rounds for time, 12 deadlifts, 9 hang power cleans, and 6 push jerks. The men will be using not 155 pounds, which is normal, but 205. And the women's loading goes from a regular 105 to 145 pounds. The event is about to take place down at the tennis stadium.